One way to give a definition of complexity is to think about what the universe looks like from one point, from one observer. So that's called the view of the rest of the universe by one observer. And you can define that in several different ways. You can take a sort of, you can imagine that we take the sphere of the world around us with all the light rays coming in from different directions. And then we can define a distance between two views of the world by how much information it requires to distinguish them.
Mm.
And then we can sum over all the pairs of views. So we can sum, we can take every pair of events and measure how different they are from each other.
Okay.
And then you can sum that over all the pairs. And that's the way.
So you're telling how different two events are or two observers are?
It's a property of the whole set.
Okay.
So some cities have much more variety than other cities.
I see.
Because it's you need less information to distinguish the pairs of corners.
And when you say put a graph and you embed it in a space, you don't mean to say, well, let's decompose a space into simplicial.
No. I imagine that there's some way in which you can compare the view on one variety of one event with the view of another event. And you can, and I can tell you lots of ways to measure how different they are. And then I can define something like a gauge theory, where the action of the theory is to increase the total variety between all the pairs.
Oh, is this related to the fecund universe?
No. So, not that I know. It might be, but I don't know what it is. But by the way, I never have used that term.
Okay. This is just what people describe your theory as.
This is a very important idea. This is one of the key ideas. I have a collection of 4 or 5 ideas which fit together very neatly.
Oh, I would love to explore that more.
So for example, the function is closely related, it turns out, to the Bohmian potential.
The function?
There's a function on a set of triples of points, okay, which can see each other. So I can describe the universe by describing every sphere in the universe looking at it. And I'm going to tell you what each event in the universe sees when it looks out. And it sees some distribution on its useful.
And so why is it 3? Why not something like 2 or 4?
Because that's the way it is in 2+1 dimensions.
Uh-huh. And this isn't related to the cubic, I forgot the term for it, but the cubic part that you were referencing earlier of loop quantum gravity, the cubic quality?
Oh, yes, of course it's related.
So it's directly related to the cubic, meaning the 3.
Yes.
The 3-3, okay.
That's another of our results.
Mm-hmm. Okay, you mentioned there are 4 or 5 results of yours that you feel like are the monumental ones that feed nicely or relate nicely to one another. Can you outline them now? Then we can explore them in detail later, but just so that we have a table of contents.
I'm going to make a causal set out of the events. And I have a universe which is constructed by taking pairs of events and joining them or not.
Okay.
And I get in that way a causal universe. I have a rule which at every moment there is a distribution of what the events at that moment see, and it's described as some distribution on the sphere.
And then you have
an action principle. The action principle depends in your own way on a product of a kinetic energy and a potential energy. And the action can be written, in fact, as the kinetic energy minus the potential energy. Mm-hmm. And the potential energy is the variety. And the kinetic energy is basically the rate of change of the variety.
Okay.
And that, when you study it for a large set, goes over into quantum mechanics. It's non-analogistic and body quantum mechanics.
So it's useful for me to have names for these. The first one you mentioned where there are two sets, is there a name for that?
I don't know.
Like, you haven't coined a name for that?
No.
Okay. And then now this one about variety, does that have a name? That's the one that you developed with Barber, or inspired by Barber.
Yes, but it's a separate, it's in the context of our, we call it causal, energetic causal sets.
Mm-hmm. Right. I have some questions about that.
Okay.
Which we'll get to later, hopefully. What else is there? You said there were a couple other ideas of yours that you feel like are the key ones.
So there's a relationship with game theory.
Mm-hmm.
And we've been developing it with some students.
Is this the work that is currently unpublished and you're still working on? Okay. That's fine.
So let me just say there's a very intriguing relationship to game theory.
Uh-huh. Okay, so there's a game theory relationship between what, loop quantum gravity in it, or the causal sets in it, or?
This current theory is describable as a game.
Okay.
So the description of the universe inside of this theory is a description of a certain kind of game.
And who would the agents in the game be? Particles?
Observers.
And they have to be rational observers?
No, they don't have to be rational. Because they don't have... These are games which go by the name of infinite games. And they don't have a desire to win. They have a desire... They have a mutual desire to keep the game going, which is what is called an infinite game.
And from this you get...
The dynamics that I was talking about.
Uh-huh. So, in game theory, there's something called mean field game theory. Is that then supposed to be the effective field theory of this physical theory?
I don't I know so little about game theory. It's embarrassing.
So, well, okay. What inspired you to go in this direction then?
I have no idea.
Not your collaborators. Just this idea just slowly developed.
Yeah. I was thinking that what a cosmology has to be. And the cosmology can't be a, we can't try to maximize something because that's what we would do if there was one observer.
Mm-hmm.
But we have many observers. So how do we describe a system that's trying to maximize something in the context of moves made by many observers?
In one of your books, you had posited the idea that the universe begins by varying the laws. And then there was actually a prediction from this.
Yes, and this leads to that idea.
Uh-huh. What I want to know about that idea is that when one says, look, let's take an evolutionary approach to cosmology. Let's vary the physical constants anytime that there's a new universe. Well, why are we choosing to vary the physical constants only? And from what set do we choose the distribution? And I'll give you an example as to where my question is leading. So let's say biology works with variation. Okay, so variation. But it's not like, look, let's have a plant. And then there are a couple of properties of a plant. There's the stem length. There's the leaf length or extent. And then there's how many leaves, how many stems, and so on. So let's tweak those parameters. Yes, we can tweak them all day, but you'll never get to a ladybug from that. Why do we think that if there's some evolutionary progress to the universe where something is being varied, we have to put a limit on this something? How do we know that that it's not the law of the excluded middle is now gone in this universe?
Right.
Or F equals
right.
M times V instead of M times A in this universe?
These are all important questions.
Yeah.
And we have to adjust them. We have to understand them.
Mm-hmm.
We're barely starting on this idea of an evolutionary universe.
So you're starting with the idea that, look, there's a few parameters in the standard model, I assume, or lambda CDM, and then you just vary those?
Yes.
Sorry, wait. What is what we call, you said this is what we call
the question of what do we vary?
Yes.
That's called the Mendelaw dilemma.
The Mendelaw.
Meta is in greater than
law. Yeah, yeah. Oh, Mendelaw dilemma.
Yeah, but it's not a dilemma. We just say yes. And we just do it again and do it again, do it again. So we accept the idea that there's a Mendelaw.
Okay. Interesting. Speaking of a realist notion of time, there is Tim Maudlin. There are a few physicists who are strident realists in time. So much so that they think it's the fundamental ontological entity. What is the difference between Tim Maudlin's idea of time and yours?
Well, I don't know his whole description or his whole theory. So I can't really comment completely on his. We have a definite structure, and that's an advantage and a disadvantage. And by the way, you should definitely mention my collaborators, and this is not just me.
Of course, yes.
Also is Marina Cortez, right, who's a cosmologist. There is Clavio Veres and a few other people, but those are the keys, and Roberto Unger.
What do you see the difference between physics and philosophy as being?
In the present world or ideally?
In our present world.
I think they're trained very differently. I think philosophers are trained to make key arguments, to learn to make a powerful argument.
Uh-huh.
And physicists are trained to discover things.
Yes.
Ideally.
And so what's the difference between physics and metaphysics?
I don't know. I don't know what metaphysics is, really.
What's the difference between when you collaborate with a physicist versus a philosopher? Because you've done both.
Yes, but philosophers I've worked with are not in the mainstream of well-trained philosophers.
Oh.
I mean, Clavia will be one by the time she's done, but she's a PhD student now. She also has another life where she's a published and much admired poet.
Interesting. So there's something called the UNRWA effect. So do you mind outlining what the UNRWA effect is and how loop quantum gravity explains it?
I don't know that loop quantum gravity explains it. It's a very good question. But the UNRWA effect says that if you take an observer, which is a constant acceleration, mu nc in space-time, the observer will see the world around it as hot with a temperature T is H bar over 2.0 C times the acceleration.
By the way, I heard that the trio of you, Carlo Rovelli, and Abhay Ashtekar, all of whom have been on the channel now, by the way, Theories of Everything, that the trio has the different advantages and disadvantages. So the advantages are Abhay is much more rigorous, and Carlo is much more metaphoric and poetic, and you are the middle ground.
No, that's not how it was in the war, but okay. Abhay is definitely very strong, looking for exact mathematics. So he's over in the camp of the mathematical physicists, and he can prove theorems. Carlo is the hippie, happy, come into my room and learn all about time version of Carlo.
What do you mean by Peter Voigt is a mathematical mystic?
I have no idea.
So I have that as a quote, but I don't remember the source.
I don't think of him as particularly either. I think he's very pragmatic. Pragmatic is the word I was looking for
to describe
a type of philosopher.
If you enjoyed that clip, then the full podcast is out right now. You can click around here. Enjoy. Subscribe to Theories of Everything to get notified of upcoming podcasts, as there are new full-length podcasts every week on the topics of mathematics, physics, consciousness, free will, and AI.